If you want to catch up quickly on what is new and what is important in the Power BI monthly update, then I bring you the highlights. Today, I'm going to cover the Power BI September 2018 update. But at the end of this video, you can also access a complete playlist of all the recent updates. Hey, I'm Avi Singh, Power BI Pro, and I help companies and individuals get quick and powerful results using the Agile method for Power BI. And if you would like to become a Power BI Pro, make sure to subscribe and click the bell so you're notified whenever I go live to answer your Power BI questions. We're going to cover the five key highlights from the September update, and number four is going to blow your mind, so make sure you stick around for that. If there are updates or changes you would like to see in Power BI, post them in the comments below so we can all vote for them. Let's start with number one, Intellisense. Now, if you have used Query Editor, and if you haven't, why not? Query Editor is the kitchen of Power BI. This is where you come to clean, shape, transform all of your data, and it's incredibly powerful. Now, 99% of what I do, okay, fine, maybe 95%, is just using the ribbon up above, and that's incredibly powerful. But you can go even deeper when you tap into the underlying M language for the Query Editor. Now, this is where Intellisense comes in. So if you were to click on the Advanced Editor, you would see the underlying code, and Intellisense is a new feature which kind of makes it all very rich, like other kind of like Visual Studio or other programming environments, where you can highlight an element and you can auto-complete. So I can say, if I was writing it out, I could say table dot, and notice how it shows me all the options, and I can go from there. So really, really cool. However, the other place where I often use this is the formula bar. If you haven't turned it on, make sure you do. This is a great way to learn and get familiar with M language, and it's not there yet, but I'm sure it's coming soon, and it's going to be pretty incredible. Number two, there are a lot of changes around reporting, so let's cover them one by one. The first one is the dot plot. Now, dot plots are kind of like scatter plots, but with a twist. So scatter plots is going to have two different measures on the x-axis and the y-axis. And what you're now able to do is to, instead of specifying measures on both axes, you can specify a category on one of these axes. So in this case, notice that the one at the bottom is not a measure, it's a category. In this case, I'm using territory, and this gives you a very different visual layout, and this can be a pretty powerful technique. This can even replace your bar charts or column charts in a lot of scenarios and show you other rich visuals. The next one is the ability to copy value and selection from table and matrix. And yeah, this is going to come in handy. So here we have a table visual, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to right click, and you can see we have the options here to copy value or copy selection. So I'm going to choose copy value, and I'm going to show you, if you paste this in Excel, it actually copies, well, in this case, I copied the label. Let me copy the sales value. So copy value, and I get just that value, so just that single value. Now instead, you can maybe select a few of these and then right click and say copy selection this time. So I'm going to choose the other option here, and now you get all the selection as promised. There you go, right? So it keeps the headers, keeps the values, and so forth. So that's pretty handy, but you can also watch a quick tip video on how you can connect an Excel pivot table to Power BI that may make doing something like this far more easier. Next up, we have report theme options. So if you're not a big fan of the color scheme used, you can go to switch theme, and now there are quite a few options available to you. Now, you also have the ability to go deeper and create your own theme files and import them here, but these would give a little more flexible options to somebody who is just starting out and just wants to experiment with a slightly different color theme set. Next up, on the report page tooltips, and I'm going to show you a quick example, they're now under general availability. It's not in preview anymore, and report page tooltips are now also supported by cards. So let's take a quick look at both of them. So the way report page tooltips work is that I have a tooltip. So again, this is this was released some time ago, but now it just came out of preview. So you can define a page which is, you set up that this is a tooltip, and then you can leverage this as a hover for some of these items. So notice I'm in bikes, and if I hover over that, it just shows me information from that tooltip page that I had just created, right? So I can go kind of bikes, show that to me, accessories, clothing. So it shows, and of course, this is totally custom built, so you can design it just the way you want. And coming back here, the other news here is that cards also support tooltips. So now if you hover over cards, you can set that up to show a specific tooltip page. Next, we have the PDF file connector. Now this is in preview, so make sure you turn it on before you try to use it, but this is pretty exciting. And now if you go to new source, more, you would see the PDF connector right there as long as you turned on the preview, or you can also search for it by using PDF. Now, we'll just do a quick test run. So connect, it gives you some warning about the preview. That's great. And I'm just gonna point to a web page that I have with the PDF file. And it's going out and connecting to that. And great, and you can see it brings in these different elements, and I'm not going to go ahead with the rest of it, but you can imagine that this can be pretty easily. What I ended up doing was combining all those tables that were available in that file and outputting a simple table back, which is going to be loaded to my model. So go ahead and try to connect to your PDF files and see how it works out for you. The next feature is aggregations, and this is pretty incredible. Now this is part of that composite model, and I'll show you how it works. So what I have here is essentially a model which is using direct query to connect to a source database. Now I will say that as a model author, that's not the default mode that I operate in as a model author. But again, in this world of self-service BI, once the IT team or the BI team or the model authors have built out a model, a lot of other users might be connecting to it in direct query mode. So this is more for kind of the self-service BI empowered user. So they're connecting to a model using direct query because they do not want to bring in possibly millions, billions of rows into their Power BI desktop. So direct query is a great way to accomplish that. And in here, all of these tables are in direct query mode. But then with the use of composite models, I can have one table here which provides me the key aggregations that are used most often, and I can set that up to import. So I'll show you, and that is all set up using simply Query Editor, but the key is that one of them, the sales aggregate table, if I click on the properties for that, hold on. So I'm just gonna right click and say properties, and here you can see that sales aggregate, I have switched this to import. Overall, this model has now a mixed storage mode because I have some direct query and some import. And that's of course composite model, which I've covered extensively in the past few videos, and we'll put a link so you can access that at the end of this video as well. So this one is import, and what that does is it takes the tables that are connected to both of them. You know what, it's just easier to show you. So think about this, that sales aggregate, so calendar and territories, those ones are driven by an imported table and are going to be obviously they're going to be stored locally, whereas this is direct query and that's going back to the server. So the performance of this one is going to be incredibly fast, and when it cannot answer these questions, when maybe you ask a question around the customer or the product which are not part of the aggregation, then it's going to go back in the direct query mode and query the server. All right, so ready? So here what I have is I took sales and I sliced and diced it using the tables that are working under direct query mode. So this is by product color and customer occupation. So let's, what I have running is a SQL Server profiler. I'm going to clean that so you can see what queries. So I'm just going to filter on a blue color and go back. And indeed, there were queries that were sent back to the server. So let's clean that up again. And let's do something on the customer table. So I click on this. And if you go back, again, there were queries that were sent back to the server because that's how direct query works. But now let's see how we can leverage the aggregation that we have both for calendar and the country table. So now I have the similar setup, but let's go ahead and wipe this off. And now let's click on United States and everything filters down, But if you go back, there was no query issued back to the server. This was answered within the model itself because this is leveraging the aggregations tables. The key is that this is stored locally in import and it's going to give you much better performance. So as a designer, as a model author, you can choose where you need the aggregation and in other cases, you always have the fallback for direct query. So you can see how incredibly powerful this can be, and this is just building on the already amazing feature of composite models. And frankly, I can't wait to see where Microsoft is headed from here. Clearly, they're not going to leave any stone unturned in the journey to empower the business users and make the self-service BI a reality for everybody. Number five, I'm just going to mention really quick. So Q&A support, obviously Power BI has had Q&A for a long time now, both on PowerBI.com, the service, and inside Power BI desktop, where you can ask questions as well. But now Q&A support has been enabled for row-level security. Now, this was a big bottleneck for those people using row-level security in their models. It did not support Q&A, but now it does. So everybody rejoice, right? So that was a recap of the September 2018 update. If you have any updates that you've been waiting for, make sure to post them in the comments below so we can all vote for them. And click the link shown here or down below to access the complete updates playlist so you can catch up on everything that's new and exciting in the recent Power BI updates. And if all of this leaves you feeling overwhelmed, I want to remind you to focus on the 20% that matters the most. And my Power BI tutorial is a great way to start on that path. Until next time, power on, my friend. Hey, keep watching more videos and keep learning Power BI. But if you did enjoy this video, I would love to hear from you. So leave a comment, like, subscribe, all the good stuff. Power on, my friends.